Certainly, all of us in this hall expect every taxpayer dollar to be spent wisely and prudently. Let's go back in time, though, before we get involved with the exact minutiae of those amendments. The defined benefit program was designed for hardworking people. The defined benefit program that teachers may have, or secretaries, members of this hall, people throughout the Commonwealth and throughout the country that have a defined benefit plan, that was defined, that was designed to make sure that when a person retired and was unable to continue to work to provide for themselves, there would be some kind of guaranteed monthly payment. Very similar to Social Security. I mean, a defined benefit plan is exactly like Social Security. And what did we have before Social Security? We had poverty. We had people that had no money when they became elderly, and therefore they became either the ward of the state or they had to live within the family. They had no money to spend. They had no money to provide economic growth. It was a matter of being able to simply survive. So we defined Social Security as a forced savings account. Social Security is a forced savings account because we recognized that a lot of folks couldn't put money away, didn't put money away, and then became wards of the state. It actually became a burden to the state, and it became a burden to the family. As we think back, and we remember the kind of dollars that people earned, you know, people made $10,000 a year, people made $20,000 a year, people make $30,000 and $40,000 a year, and part of their pay goes into their Social Security, part of their pay goes into Medicare. How much could a person that makes $40,000 a year and raises a family, how much money could they actually put away for their pension that would sustain their life when they retired? Or at $50,000 or $60,000, how much could they put away raising a family? Could they put away $1,000 a year? Could they put away $2,000 a year? You work 30 years and you put $2,000 away, you have $60,000 in the bank. That's enough to sustain you? Certainly not. Let's say you make $80,000 a year, you put $5,000 away every year for 30 years. That's $150,000. That's a lot better. But how long will $150,000 last if you have to take a monthly payment in order to live? Certainly not very long. Social Security was designed so that people in their most vulnerable years, when they don't have the ability to work, when they don't have the ability to take care of themselves, there would be a monthly stipend that would come in to help them sustain their lives and to go on with some dignity. That is what a defined benefit plan is. And our defined benefit plan in PSERS and in SERS was 125% fully funded. It was fully funded before the legislature changed the formula. When the formula was 2%, when the state paid their portion of their responsibility, there was never a financial problem, there was never an unfunded mandate, and the people were able to retire with dignity. But with a defined contribution, a 401k, you're at the mercy of the market, aren't you? So when the market is good, your 401k looks pretty good. But when your market is not so good, your 401k is diminished greatly. But a defined benefit plan, which is what we have, what they have, no matter how the market fluctuates, the people in that system are guaranteed their monthly stipend. That's why we have a defined benefit. That's why we have Social Security. And the history behind a 401k, that was a tax shelter for wealthy people. Wealthy people would take this money, put it into a 401k, and therefore they wouldn't be taxed on it. It was a good financial move. And they didn't have to worry. When you're wealthy, and God bless them, that's terrific. They have the attorneys, they have the accountants, they have the Wall Street managers to help them manage that tax shelter account. But to our constituents, to most of the people that are our family and friends, to those that are our constituents in our districts, they don't have a battery of lawyers. They don't have a battery of consultants or CPAs. They needed some kind of retirement system that would be safe, secure, and guaranteed. That's what a defined benefit plan is. And ladies and gentlemen, we should be working so that everybody has the opportunity of a defined benefit plan. We hear the story that businesses and large companies have gone to 401k plans. Why? Why did they go to 401k plan and not a defined benefit plan? Because it's more advantageous to the company. It costs the company less. And we've all heard about the stories where the companies have had some difficulty and they go bankrupt. Do they not? And when they go bankrupt, they renegotiate the pension and the people that were employed by that company and invested in that company and invested in that pension program, now it's cut in half, eliminated. That doesn't happen with a defined benefit plan. So when we come back and we look at our own situation here, and we're talking about $50 billion of unfunded liability, there were three major things that occurred that made that unfunded liability happen. What were they? The first thing that occurred was when the legislator changed the percentage from 2 to 2.5. At 2.5, it began withdrawing more out of that fund. And then for 10 years or more, the state did not fund that fund at the level that the law required. So while we begin to struggle today to find money, and we heard the term $600 million more than last year, ladies and gentlemen, if the state upheld its responsibility 10 years ago and for 10 years, we wouldn't be in this shape that we're in today. The state still owes that fund with interest over $10 billion. We also have a plan out here that's floating that says we should bond about $9 billion so that we can put that into the fund. Because that's what the fund needs. The fund needs the infusion of about $9 or $10 billion. That will fix the unfunded liability. How does that work? Right now, because the fund was depleted, they are managers. The fund managers cannot invest at the level that they need to. Therefore, the return is less than we want. So the more money you have, the more aggressive you can invest, the higher your return. So when we come back and we talk about this defined benefit plan is not working, I want to make it very clear here to you. The defined benefit plan not only did work, it could still work if we did those things that we're supposed to. And what did we do in 2010? In 2010, this legislature corrected that percentage. We took the 2.5 away. We eliminated the option of withdrawal. And that fund, that law, that Act 120 will correct our defined benefit system in PSERS and SERS in the same amount of time as the Tobash plan. So the Tobash plan doesn't help us with the budget. The Tobash plan doesn't infuse any dollars in the unfunded liability, which is what we need. It simply makes the whole retirement system in stress. Every financial manager has stated time and time and time again, you cannot support two systems. When you create the second system, you take away from the first system. When that system loses those dollars, that system collapses. The other thing that occurs, the clip point in this plan is $50,000. Up to that point, you're in defined benefit. After that point, you go into your 401k plan. Well, it takes quite a long time to get to that point. So you'll be starting out trying to put a few bucks into your 401k plan at a much greater age. 401k's plan, all of these plans only work when you put in early and allow that money to be invested and then to grow. So as we come back and review this again, I want to make it very clear to everyone that's listening. The defined benefit plan that we had in place for PSERS and SERS at the 2% at the proper state funding would be solid, it would be viable, and it would be working. In 2008, when we had the collapse, that was the third item, that was the third factor that hurt our system, because the collapse was so gigantic. The financial collapse of this country of 2008 created such dramatic concerns financially. It was compared to the crash of 1929. So the three factors that changed our system was 2% to 2.5, the state not paying their share in, and the collapse in 08. But in 2010, we began the correction. In 2008, we brought that percentage back to the 2%. That system now will begin to correct itself over that same time frame, 20, 30 years. Today, we are on this floor not only going to talk about the defined benefit, the defined contribution, that 401k plan, but we may vote on it. And I caution everybody in this room about voting on it. We haven't had any hearings on this plan. We haven't had any hearings on this plan that will affect literally millions of people. With every effort that we have, we should be working hard to get a defined benefit plan for all the people that we represent. This is the only safe, guaranteed way a person can retire when they know how much dollars they will be getting on a monthly basis, just like Social Security. The last thing that I would like to leave you with the folks that have defined benefit, the folks that go to work every day, the folks that pay their taxes, the folks that do everything they're supposed to, they follow the law, the folks that are trying to survive, the folks that are raising a family, these are our constituents. These are the people that should all have the defined benefit plan. If you don't have a defined benefit plan, that doesn't mean you should try to take it away from those that do. Because we've demonstrated and can demonstrate that when a defined benefit plan is funded appropriately and is managed appropriately, it is the best, safest, most practical retirement plan for hardworking folks, not only in this state, but in these United States. At this point, I thank you very much. I thank the speaker for allowing me this time, and I look forward to the rest of the debate. I would encourage everyone to seriously think extremely carefully about what you do today, because your vote could affect the lives of millions of people. Thank you very much.